Hi, I'm Andrea Miller, Research Assistant for European Art to 1800 at the St. Louis Art Museum. The animated movie Shrek celebrates its 20th anniversary this year and is the focus of this Art Plus Movies program. Of the four Shrek animated movies currently in the series, the original Shrek, released in 2001, is my favorite. The main character Shrek is a bad-tempered, solitary giant ogre with a kind heart who begrudgingly accepts the quest to rescue Princess Fiona. This results in him finding friends and going on many adventures in a fairytale world. The movie begins with Shrek, who is angered when fairytale creatures are ordered by Lord Farquaad to live in his swamp. On his way to confront Lord Farquaad, Shrek befriends a talking donkey, whose name is Oddly Donkey, and they set off on an adventure to meet with Lord Farquaad. We soon find out that Lord Farquaad desperately needs to marry a princess, in this case Princess Fiona, so he can become the king of Duloc. When Shrek and Donkey arrive at the palace, they are forced to rescue Princess Fiona from an enormous fire-breathing dragon in exchange for Shrek's swamp to be freed of the fairy tale creatures. Shrek heroically saves Princess Fiona and barely escapes the fire-breathing dragon's wrath. You might be wondering what the connection could possibly be between Shrek and the museum's collection. In fact, there are two important scenes in the movie that directly made me think of our collection. The first is the location of the wedding of Princess Fiona and Lord Farquaad. The beautiful setting in which they're about to wed, more specifically, the backdrop of this scene immediately reminded me of the interiors of French Gothic churches and cathedrals during the Middle Ages. In the middle of the 12th century, a distinctive new style of architecture emerged, known as Gothic. It coincided with the growing power of the French monarchy, and within 100 years, an estimated 2,700 Gothic churches were built just in the Île-de-France region that surrounds Paris. Advances in building technology allowed progressively larger windows and even loftier vaults supported by streamlined skeletal buttressing. Throughout Europe, the Gothic style spread and prevailed until about 1400. The first so-called Gothic building was the Abbey Church of Saint-Denis, just north of Paris. The dramatic achievement of the builders of Saint-Denis created architecture that emphasized open, flowing spaces enclosed by non-load-bearing walls of colorful, glowing stained glass. Large interior spaces were a practical need to accommodate the crowds of pilgrims who visited churches to venerate religious relics. These visitors needed to be able to move easily from shrine to shrine. This permitted pilgrims to circulate freely from chapel to chapel without disrupting regular church services. The light captured in stained glass windows created radiant pictures that must have captivated a faithful population whose everyday existence included little or no color outside of the natural world. The filtered light that passed through these windows transformed interior spaces into a multicolored haze. They provided visual expressions of Christian doctrine and invitations to faithful living, encouraging worshipers to follow in the footsteps of the saints whose lives were frequently featured in these stained glass windows. This brings us to an example in our collection. The stained glass window was once part of a series depicting Jesus' ancestors that adorned the upper walls of an abbey in Braine, France. Seated beneath an archway reminiscent of canopies that covered the altar, this male figure was most likely represents a descendant of Adam and Eve's third son, Seth. He holds a rolled scroll in his left hand and raises his right hand in gesture of speech. The fleur-de-lis decoration above this canopy, while dated to the late medieval period, was probably not original part of this window and was added later. In Shrek, we see only Lord Farquaad depicted within all the stained glass windows, perhaps for reasons of hubris, but for all we know, he could have been a descendant of Adam and Eve's third son as well. The second key scene from the movie that made me think of our collection was the one where Shrek is forced to accept the challenge to save Princess Fiona. The scene takes place in Lord Farquaad's palace, where multiple knights in full suits of armor are charging at Donkey and Shrek. This made me think of field armor from the collection, very similar in appearances to the ones we see in the movie. Field armor, made for war, was the most common type of armor in the Middle Ages and the Renaissance period. Well-made, head-to-toe armor combined protection, flexibility, and comfort while limiting weight. These examples were made mainly for horsemen. Using primarily hand tools, the master armor and his assistants tailored plates of iron and steel to wearer's dimensions. The design was affected not only by a particular battlefield needs, but by art trends and fashion as well. The museum also has a large collection of weapons from this period that includes mace, spears, and decorative halberds. I hope you've enjoyed exploring these fun and unexpected connections between Shrek and the art and architecture of the Middle Ages with me, and that it might inspire you to seek out other connections on your own. Thank you for watching this Art Plus Movies program. We invite you to share this link to connect family and friends with Art Plus Movies. You can also connect with us on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and YouTube.